Patients will continue their rights under Proposition 215. The home growth is still going to be allowed, although I'm not personally a member of grower or anything, so I grew a couple of kids. Patient privacy is protected. Sales tax will not be collected from patients. Parental rights are there, and there's going to be research funded for medical cannabis. The environmental regulations are going to be strong. This is really typical in California. We've seen this now, and we encourage this. And when Terrence and I started the political action committee and the educational group here, we had one of our founding principles, protection of the environment, and that became a real important cornerstone of the work we did, particularly up in California and cultivating counties. And in fact, Humboldt County, which was one of our main chapters that passed the ordinance, kind of groundbreaking, nationally, sort of first of its kind land use ordinance, has very strong environmental protections. Those are going to take some time to implement because people are used to taking water from rivers or not necessarily building ponds. There's a lot of restrictions on how it's going to be done. We're going to see a lot of effort to create better farming practices, protocols for cannabis farmers. And the agencies will be looking at environmental impact before they issue licenses. So for those who are going to be cultivating outdoors, where there's going to be a lot of focus on land use, water, the water is there, and pesticide, rodenticide use, and slope of the hills. Okay. And there again, there's going to be a dedicated stream of revenue from the state for environmental restoration protection for remediation. The money that comes in will pay for the cost of the regulation. There's going to be $10 million for public universities for research, $3 million for the highway patrol to establish DUI protocols. You know, every study that has been done by the National Highway Traffic Transportation Institute has shown no statistical impact of cannabis use for deaths or accidents. But you can't seem to get that message across to law enforcement. And so these are the kind of compromises, again, that are made that in order to get, again, those Southern California voters. We don't really worry about the Northern California voters. We'll vote for anything on the ballot, pretty much that will legalize cannabis up here. Not truly in Southern California. The UC San Diego Center for Medicinal Cannabis Research, that's Dr. Hugo Grant, who was instrumental in doing the initial studies on AIDS patients and neuropathic pain. They're going to get money. You're going to see $10 million increasing annually by $10 million for 5 years, peaking at $50 million, distributed for community reinvestment. That could be very significant. It's going to be grants, programs. This could be a real shift. 60% of the remaining funds go to youth drug prevention, education, treatment, 20% towards environmental restoration protection, and then the cops go there 20%. Except that if a city or county bans cannabis under the adult use, bans the licensing, they won't get to share in the taxes. So it's a little bit of a you know, incentive for them to do something. Legalize California 2016, and there's their slogan is "Let's get it right," and that's basically an overview of what is a massive 62-page document, which I put up on my screen. Kendra's got it next to her. And without further ado, we'll open this up for questions. And so we'll go one at a time. If you need a microphone, let us know. We can try to maybe come up here so that everyone can hear you. Do you guys want to take it? Please, come on.
We can talk about it.
I'm wondering, like, a five-year ban.
Right.
Concerned about that fiber and not protecting small farmers.
to cultivate anywhere between 10,001 to 1 acre of outdoor and 10,001 to 22,000 square feet of indoor in what the legislature is called mixed light. That's pretty large, right, for most people. I think an acre of outdoor, based on what my cultivator clients have told me, that's a lot in labor. It's a lot of meat. So then what it looks like what we're protecting is the right for people who want to compete in the cultivating level within, so essentially 1 acre or less of outdoor, 22,000 square feet or less of indoor mixed light, that amount of cultivation will be protected for a period of 5 years, because I believe the small business owners, the small farmers in particular, who are concerned about protecting this industry that they created on their backs, are concerned about big pharma and big business coming in, buying up acres and acres and acres of weed, so that one day we'll be driving down the 101 and for 50 miles straight, there'll be nothing but cannabis. I think that was the concern.
But basically this law allows that in 5 years.
In 5 years, correct. To give the small farmers in California a running start. Yes.
So, Chris Shaw, the Captain of the Scrolls Alliance.
Welcome.
You know, I want you to take a
look.
Yeah, I want you to hear who you are.
Can you come up and just take it easy? Come up and face everyone and talk to everyone.
I'm with the Red County Cannabis Growers Alliance and the San Luis Obispo County Cannabis Growers Alliance. They're two sister organizations. So I'm just curious, is there going to be a limit to these farms after 5 years?
That's a great question. The question is, will there be a limit? I don't know. And I think it will have a lot to do with the activism of the people who are already in the industry and involved, and the lobbying efforts of those bigger industries who are looking to have much larger farms, larger than an acre.
And my particular question is, 920 to 925 per ounce tax, is the farmer responsible for that, or is the distributor responsible for that?
I am going to let Matt answer that question, because I don't know anything about taxes.
Just so they raised the distributor model, under the MMRSA, which is our medical law passed in October, signed by Governor Brown, every bit of cannabis that is grown, manufactured, and distributed has to be touched by a distributor. And for those who have been involved in alcohol regulation, that is the law for alcohol regulation. It's called a Title 11 license, and it was lobbied hard for by the alcohol industry, and they got it. And it means that you, unless you're in a special sort of little exception under the MMRSA, you can, if you're a grower and you want to sell to a brick and mortar facility that's licensed, and you're licensed, you can cut your deal, but you're going to have to send it up to the distributor, and the distributor's going to slice off a piece of that.
That's right. Distribution is key.
Now, under the AUMA, there is no mandatory distribution. So you will have distributors out there who people may find it easier. You know, I mean, as a service, if you're a farmer and you want to get your product to LA, well, you can just get it to a distributor. So that they may choose to do that. But they won't be required to enter the AMA. Yes, Michelle? Well, the dispensaries won't be paying a tax. They're going to be required to collect a sales tax. But there will be, and the consumer will.
Oh, yes.
The 15% plus the local. They wanted more. And to answer your question, though, the farmers will be paying the tax on what they grow. So the 9 1/4 and then the full bud and then the 2 point, what was the number, 2 point? On the leaf.
Is that all what you grow or what you sell?
That'll be what you sell.
Okay. Also, is the MMJ exemption for products that they have products in the MMJ market? Is that
the MMRSA doesn't have, that's what they're trying to do actually in Sacramento. They're trying to tax the medical market at the production source, but they don't have that yet. But the AUMA does. They're exempting from the patients from the retail sales tax, but they didn't put it in place, the legislature didn't put it in place, excise, what are called excise or special taxes on the growers under the MMRC. And I'm going to try to be really careful, we should all be really thinking about the difference between the MMRC, which was passed by the legislature, and then this one.
So let me just deal with that to make sure that we're all on the same page. For the last 20 years under Prop 215, we've essentially had a completely vertically integrated model. And the 2008 guidelines written by then Attorney General Jerry Brown came out with this concept of the closed loop, right? So essentially in the closed loop model, everything had to be done in-house if you were a collective or cooperative. Cultivation, manufacture, distribution, transportation, lab testing, retail, all had to be done in-house under a closed loop. Now, everything changed in October of last year when now Governor Jerry Brown signed into law the three bills making up the MMRSA. What the MMRSA did was take this totally vertically integrated model, right? Put it horizontally and chop it up into six pieces, now requiring that you have a local permit and a state license in order to engage in that particular cannabis activity. Not only that, what the MMRSA did was put restrictions on which licenses you could apply for at the state level. The MMRSA put a lot of power into local government. It's really important that you understand that. The local city council, boards of supervisors can ban under MMRSA. Under ALMA, you need a vote of the people. Can they? Well, they said here in the bottom of E, you know, but this is the old version. All right, when did they change? Oh, they took it out. So now they cannot ban. What part do they do? You don't need a vote of the people, they can do it by city council?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a problem. That's a major problem that I see under MMRSA. Okay, so vertically integrated model has been passed 20 years. Now horizontal, you need a local permit, state license, yes?
Thank you for recognizing me. I would like to add also of your vertical versus horizontal. When it was vertical like this under Proposition 215, it was a not-for-profit
correct
system.
Correct.
And now when it's only a horizontal,
yes,
it is for-profit.
Correct.
Every state of the
world. Absolutely. Thank you for bringing up that point. We were mutual benefit, not-for-profit, democratically controlled under 215 in that vertically integrated model. Now we can be for-profit under MMRSA.
There's a woman that's been waiting very patiently back there.
What about collectives that we used to be in under Prop 215?
Can you stand up and come up and
we could grow. We used to be able to grow 99 plants for Prop 215.
We're trying to report, so it would be nice if we could put it in.
Not all patients have grow space. Some of those live in water rooms.
So, ask your question.
There is no, what's going to happen if somebody can't grow 99 plants for 20 people?
So, what's important now is that you're in compliance with the local land use and zoning laws wherever your garden is located. That's important. So, if you're in an urban area, there are going to be, of course, restrictions on your ability to cultivate that you would not find in a more rural area. So, the number one thing in determining where you're going to conduct your cannabis business is what are the rules in the city or the county in which I plan to invest my time and money? And some of you that have investors, you have a duty to protect those investors. And if you move into an area that bans, you can't conduct activity in that area, so do your research. The local governments have a lot of power. Was there another question?
Let's take someone else and then we'll come back.
The young lady in the back with the black striped shirt.
Okay. And just, Terrence just informed me that there's pizza in about 5 minutes, so we'll take a few more questions and then we'll make it right. Somebody eat. But let's spread the questions around and we'll come back.
Yeah. We have a new person right here.
Yeah.
Can you
also tell us who you are, because you have a status?
Sorry, I'm Jocelyn Kane of the Entertainment Commission. I'm also a member of the task force, and one of the questions that we've asked currently, I haven't gotten an answer yet on, is IUMA is an initiative, and it is what it is. If it passes,
law. There's the legislative avenues, you can go to your representatives. Did you have any particular thoughts?
Well, let me back up for a second, because it's really important point, and it was what finally, when they twisted my arm about this, it's kind of what made me sort of finally say, okay. Typically in a citizen's initiative like Prop 215, unless it says in there that the legislature can tweak and do something with it, you can't. That's what happened to People versus Kelly in 2010. The legislature in 2003 put a plant limit and a possession limit, and finally litigated that all the way to the Supreme Court of California and said, hey, you can't limit what patients can, because it didn't say. But what they did in this initiative, which actually is in a broader spirit of initiative changes going on in California right now in newly enacted laws about initiatives, is they're trying to get bring the legislators and the people a little bit closer together. Because when you look at court opinions about citizens' initiatives, what the courts always talk about is there's a deadlock in the legislature, and us, the citizens, come in and we break the deadlock. And that was the philosophical underpinning of the initiatives. They're now recognizing over the years that when citizens try to make law, it's just as messy as when the legislature. And so we have problems that were locked in. For example, our Prop 13, our tax, property tax thing, brought our state's jewel of a school system and college system from first in the nation to 49th. So in terms of student expenditure, and that can't be touched except by another initiative. So there was a broad movement lately to change how we do it, and the drafters of this initiative recognize that we shouldn't be locked in to, for example, an ounce. I can get arrested for an ounce and a quarter as a criminal penalty, but I can't be arrested for an ounce. There's a way in which the logic of that is difficult to swallow. So what they said was the legislature can change that. And so when I finally had a conversation with Tamara Todd at DPA, who was doing drafting, she said, well, we're not going to be able to get this local control thing. I was, kind of mouthing off a little bit about the 1 ounce limit, and she said, well, all we can tell you today is that we're going to just have to keep lobbying and keep changing the law, and that this initiative allows that, unlike many other citizen initiatives. I can find it for you at the break, and I'll show you. It's towards the end. But basically, it allows the license types can be changed, and also the penalties can be changed, and the amounts can be changed of cannabis possession. So that is something, and as a political person, as an advocate, as a lobbyist, that's something that you can work on, so it's not like this is set in stone. Yeah, Michelle.
And it's smoking public, never going to help.
Because they're treating it like tobacco.
Treating it like tobacco.
Stop Section 3 or Section 6
of the
right. No,
they're treating it like cigarette smoke. Yeah.
So we can
even
open a entertainment place where we can go in because that's a public place.
They may do, like they have a lot of bars and they have bars now that have like special smoking areas that you can have, and so you may be able to do that. The legislature wanted to protect employees from secondhand smoke, and again, we're at the beginning of a process of educating
the definition of smoke in the ALMA includes electronic cigarettes, so yes.
Included. Yes, anyone not asked a question, if you had a question, yes. And then I'm going to go back to everyone. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, Jennifer, sir. You look familiar.
Yeah. I think I've asked this question before. And it's still
real loud.
Will you be able to smoke on the sidewalk if you smoke cigarettes? There's just no public smoking marijuana and cigarettes.
Where you cannot smoke tobacco, you cannot smoke a cannabis product.
No, and the law of that, there is no smoking
in the law. Right. Well, so like for Palo Alto to answer your question, you can't smoke on the sidewalk, smoke tobacco on the sidewalk.
What about San Francisco?
It's So I don't know, I would have to look it up. But my understanding is that where there are tobacco restrictions, and it may be broader, but where there are tobacco restrictions, as a general rule, you wouldn't be able to smoke. What are your thoughts on that?
I think Michelle's correct that they're banning smoking in all places. And this is, again, a problem, you know, although I do think that the local, and this is where the task force and where our, if I could just finish, and then where the local city and county may be able to relax that. And I think that's going to be one of the challenges for the task force to look at that. Yeah. I believe that section is not changed.
To the revenue section.
Yeah, the revenue section is not changed. I believe the legislature could not change that. They decided to. I see your hand, and I really want to get to people who. And Michael, you haven't asked a question, and I want to get to you. And you've asked a few. I'm just trying to spread that a little bit. Okay, I'll get there. Okay, I'm going to do that. Just like that, Michael, and then. You next, and then you have a question too. Let's do it in that order. The initiative, unlike most citizen initiatives, first of all, did give powers to change it to the legislature. Let's start there, okay? But they didn't give them all the powers to change all of it, okay? Only Section 3 is the licensing provisions and the penalties provisions, okay? So that was designed so that we could go in and we can actually start to push up that. Now, I like to have a bottle of rum, a bottle of vodka, and a bottle of some beer and wine in my liquor cabinet. I might like to have some purple kush. I might like to have an ounce of this and an ounce of that. If they want to treat like alcohol, we can get there. So that's, and the revenue provision, though, is locked in. So let me get to Michael. Thanks. You get the Mike. And just for those of you who don't know Mike Balfitch, he's a hero. He's been in this thing for 50 years.
I have all kinds of arguments with Alma. I do not think it should be passed. I will work against it and I will vote against it. But two of the main things that concern me, one of which you haven't even mentioned, is that Alma says that you must possess a state ID card. This totally destroys the confidentiality, not only of that information, but it creates a list of marijuana users in California, which the state owns. I don't want that list to exist. That's the same argument we have with registering AIDS patients in California years ago. We should not allow that to pass. Secondly, not only possession of 1 ounce or transportation of 1 ounce, but giving away more than 1 ounce is illegal under Alma. What that means is that my job at Spark, which is distributing free compassion marijuana to about 50 patients, would be totally illegal because it's illegal to give away more than 1 ounce. And moreover, my driving around and distributing it to people who can't get out of their own apartments because they're so disabled would be illegal under this law. Both against Alma.
So, Michelle, I want to address your point really quickly. 11362.3 says, subsection A, nothing in this section shall be construed to permit any person to, one, smoke or ingest marijuana or marijuana products in any public place, comma, except in accordance with section 26200 of the BUP code. Right, so I have to look it up on my phone.
Good, yeah.
Hi, so do you have a microphone?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, thank you for coming. I'm Max Esdale. I'm not here in any official capacity. I just love marijuana and don't want to see it
love of you, that's sweet, thank you.
My question is in regard to, you mentioned the horizontal versus the vertical structure of the industry. Am I mistaken in believing in my interpretation that AUMA still preserves some amount of vertical integration?
Yes.
You are able to apply the local licenses across,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, okay. With limitations.
Can we discuss those limitations a bit, and is that also up for change in the future and at a local level? I was just hoping you could discuss that.
So I know that MMRSA restrictions on the different state licenses you can have better than the ALMA restrictions. I'm assuming that they're kind of the same. Are they similar or the same?
With the MMRSA, you can apply two license types, and then there's certain restrictions. For example, if you're a distributor under MMRSA,
you don't get any other license type except for transport. So they don't want they really want to isolate those, again, those in the liquor industry, you know, that they don't want the people who distribute to have an incentive to increase liquor sales. That's part of what we're still in. You know, 85 years after the end of Prohibition, they're still trying to limit the amount of liquor in the society, okay? That's kind of what we're dealing with, from a large 30,000 foot view on cannabis. They're trying to limit the amount of cannabis in society. That's what this is about. But if they did in Washington State, they put a cap on total cultivation of cannabis in Washington State, thanks to Mark Klein, UCLA, former UCLA. So that's the MMRSA. With the AUMA, I believe you can get up to four licenses, if I'm not mistaken.
Sounds right.
Right. And so, and they will be strict like they did with, you won't be able to get a distribution license, but you'll be able to have a cultivation license, manufacturing license.
So let me explain the nuance under MMRSA, okay? So there are four basic types of cultivation licenses available, right? Type 1, 0 to 5,000 square feet of total canopy on one premises, outdoor indoor mixed light. Type 2, 5,000 to 2,000 square feet of total canopy on one premises, indoor outdoor mixed light. Type 3, same thing, 10,001 to 1 acre outdoor, 10,001 to 22,000 square feet indoor mixed light. And then type 4 nursery, right? So if you have a type 1 or a type 2 cultivation license, then you can apply for a type 10A retail. Type 10A retail limits you to 3 stores throughout the state of California versus just a type 10 retail. I don't know what those restrictions are yet. The Bureau of Medical Marijuana Regulation is figuring this out. So essentially what I'm giving you in that example is that if you're growing 10,000 or cultivating 10,000 square feet or less, then you can have 3 stores in the state. I'm still looking, Sean.
Yeah.
Well, I have 2 questions. One is, I see in the very first sentence here, sentencing reform, legalizing plants, blah, 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 for adults 21 and up. How many people here smoke pot in college?
Exactly.
Okay, problem right there.
Oh, there's a lot of problems.
Because then we continue to criminalize people under the age of 21.
Correct.
What
they've done is they've reduced the penalties for under 21, but they haven't decriminalized it for under 21. And that's because they're still debating whether or not cannabis, I'm just saying they still think that cannabis for young people is a no-no. Okay.
So it's vodka here.
I don't think you're going to find anyone arguing with that.
So I'm just pointing out that is in the legislation.